And joining us this morning is Westchester County Executive George Latimer, who is competing against Bowman in the race. First of all, thank you for joining us. We appreciate it.
Happy to be with you. Kurt, Rosanna, a pleasure.
Well, let's start right there with what the congressman had to say yesterday. That's been a big accusation throughout this campaign from him, is that a lot of your money that's being funded in your campaign is by Republican donors. You know, bipartisanship is really welcomed in this country right now.
Right.
But you don't usually see that in a primary because it's all Democrats here. And looking at research, a lot of your money has come from Republican donors and Republican organizations. Why do you think they're supporting you, and why are you accepting money from Republicans in a Democratic primary?
Well, Kurt, let me push back, because what Jamal is upset about is that we've had success in raising money on the issue that he has been so poorly received on, and that is support for Israel. And the donations that I have may be coming from people who are by registration Republican, but they're scoring about the issue of his hostility to Israel. That's why they're donating. I've had support in the past in Westchester County from Republicans as well as Democratic donors. It's also important to note that when he talks about the source of that money, AIPAC, he fails to mention that same source of money supports Hakeem Jeffries, Grace Meng, Richie Torres, Greg Meeks, Adriano Espaillat. They're all Congress members, Democrats of color here that represent the New York metropolitan area. Jamal's position on Israel stands outside the mainstream, and the mainstream is represented by those members of Congress, which is the same positions I hold. So that's really what generates the money. I might add, 2 years ago, he had the advantage in this race against the prior folks from his money, and most of his money he gets is from outside the district. 90% of his money comes from outside, more money from California than from New York. So we should be talking about issues. I'm happy to talk about issues. He wants to talk about source of money because he really doesn't have a strong enough record to run on its own.
Well, you hit on the other topic, and the reason so much money is pouring into this is because this has become a national referendum almost, this district, on the Israel-Hamas war and really the internal battle within the Democratic Party between the progressive wing and the more moderate wing. Most people perceive, he represents progressive wing. Mm. You're the more moderate Democrat. Do you feel like it's important for you to push out the progressive wing?
Here's the thing. I'm progressive by normal standards of what progressivity is. Mm-hmm. Do you support LGBTQ rights? Do you support climate change? He represents a radical element, an element that goes beyond what most people want. His attitude toward Israel has been framed by some of his early statements where he wanted a ceasefire before there was any aggressive action by Israel, and the Hamas interests were being served by that, not the interests of peace. So what I would say is this. From a national level, people look down from 10,000 feet and they see the Israeli-Gaza argument as being front and center. But I'm out in the community every day, in the Bronx and in Westchester. I know Westchester like I know the palm of my hand. I've represented it for a long time. I have a lot of grassroots support. The voters are talking about affordability. They're talking about jobs. They're talking about transportation issues. The Israel-Gaza issue has been framed because he has radical position on that issue, and that's what generated the
attention. But he has apologized now. He was here yesterday, and he justified his earlier comments by saying he was waiting for the United Nations to kind of weigh in on this, and then he framed his comments differently. Should he be forgiven?
Well, look, I think we all want to be forgiven. That's part of our faith tradition. He's apologizing for the stuff he said, in which he said that rape victims, women who were mutilated, were actually part of a propaganda effort.
Right.
He said that 6 weeks after it happened. Now, he's apologizing now, and that's good. It's 3 days before an election.
Right.
So, you know, maybe it's a deathbed conversion that makes you realize that you've had an unpopular position. But if he's apologized, we'll accept that apology. But the bottom line is his mindset on these issues is not consistent with this district. And I think that's probably the disconnect. When the voters vote, some are voting now, early voting, mm-hmm. when the rest vote on Tuesday, if there is an upset of an incumbent, people want to interpret it, as he wants you to interpret it, as about money. It's not about money. It's about not being connected to the way the people of Co-op City, Tarrytown, Portchester view their representatives.
Okay, apparently, according to a newly published article, a lot of people in Co-op City came out to vote. Is that good for Jamal Bowman?
I think that helps him in that he has represented Co-op City before, and I'm not anywhere near as well known in Co-op City. But when you look at the total district, 15% of the district is in the Bronx, 85% of the district is in Westchester. Even those areas demographically that represent African-American or Latino populations in Westchester are places that I have run before, done well in, and have lots of endorsements and local relationships. In the Bronx, there's no question he has greater identification. He'll do well in the Bronx, no doubt. But in the overall district, I think I'm going to be very competitive. And for those people that assume that incumbents can't lose, keep an eye on this election.
I want to give you a chance to either clarify or defend a couple statements that a lot of people seem to have trouble with that you've said this week. First one, I want to get this right, so read it from my phone because I don't want to misquote you here. It was in an interview that was published yesterday by Punchbowl News where you were quoted as saying, is he, meaning Bowman, going to get at least 40% of the vote? Yes. Does he have an obvious ethnic benefit? Yes. And that follows earlier this week in the debate when you said his constituents are in Dearborn, meaning Michigan. There are 35,000 municipalities in the country. Yeah. You chose the one that is majority Arab. Is there a message you're trying to send?
Did you misspeak?
That's what I'm asking.
No, it's a misquote. What I said at the time was he has raised money from San Francisco and Dearborn, Michigan, not in the district. That was what the quote was. When I referenced Dearborn, Michigan, I mentioned it because he formed a joint fundraising committee with Representative Tlaib, who represents Dearborn, Michigan. And she has raised, I believe she's contributed $500,000 to his race and to another squad member race. That's why I mentioned Dearborn, Michigan. In that sentence, I also mentioned San Francisco because he had made a major fundraiser in San Francisco. So in the effort to try to play the ethnic game, he accuses this of being a dog whistle about something. Yes, it isn't. It's a straight fact of where money has been raised. It's been raised from those different sites and what have you. When somebody asks me, as you just did a second ago, how are you going to do in the Bronx? I give you an honest answer. I don't give you the political answer. Well, you know, we're working hard and we're going to... He has an advantage where he has greater name recognition and where people identify with him more closely, and that's the truth. So in terms of how that plays out, that's not a sign of my being ethnically oriented. That's a sign of an honest answer of what the circumstances are. When I say I have greater name recognition in Westchester County and I'm going to do better in Westchester County, that's not a racial statement. That's a demographic statement of, in this area, I'm better known, I've run before, I've won primaries before in these communities. And I think this shows the effort, Kurt, that he's trying to make to justify his third term. Under normal circumstances, an incumbent doesn't even mention the challenger in these races, right? Mm-hmm. I've been an incumbent in a lot of races. If my challenger said this, that, and the other thing, I ignore that. I talk about my record. He's pressured in this race. He knows he's in trouble. The polling data shows it. And it shows that he hasn't sealed the deal with the people that know him and know me.
Mm. All right. Well, thank you so much for coming on Good Day New York. We'll be keeping a close eye on the race. George Latimer.
It's a pleasure.
Appreciate it.
Thank you both very much.
Thank you for the time. We appreciate it.